Hi, I'm Pat Coslett with Pat Coslett's Furniture Festival. The tape you're getting ready to watch was produced right here in our store with a live crowd of over 700 people on a really wonderful Saturday night. We raised over $20,000 that night for the Pearl the Pig Scholarship Foundation. So sit back, relax, enjoy the video, and Michael Martin Murphy and I will be back to talk to you soon.
Evansville, Indiana, will you welcome with me the world's number one selling cowboy singer, Mr. Michael Martin Murphy.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
There is a great American hero that we all look up to. And when times are hard and chips are down, he knows just what to do. A cowboy's got a set of rules that he lives by day to day. And if you ask for his advice, he'll more than likely say, if it's a fence, mend it. If it's a dollar bill, spend it before it burns a hole in the government's jeans. If it's a load, truck it. If it's a punch, duck it. If she's a lady, then treat her like a queen. That's cowboy logic every cowboy's got. It's in the way he lives his life, songs he sings. That's cowboy logic every cowboy's got. He's got a simple solution just about anything. If it's a job, do it. Put your old back into it, 'cause a little bit of dirt's gonna wash off in the rain. If it's a horse, ride it. If it hurts, hide it. Dust yourself off, son, get back on again. That's cowboy logic every cowboy's got. It's in the way he lives his life, songs he sings. That's cowboy logic every cowboy's got. Got a simple solution, just about anything. Now an old cowboy and a young buckaroo were out working, riding fence. So the old man thought he'd test this kid on his working skills and common sense. He said, son, if you saw three men riding in the front of a pickup dressed alike from boot to hat, could you tell which one was the real cowboy just from where he sat? Well, the kid, he scratched his head a while. He said, old man, there ain't no way to know. The old fella said, son, on this outfit, you got a long, long way to go. You see, the real cowboy's the one who sits in the middle, son. He ain't just there by fate. First of all, you know he's the real cowboy if he's sitting in the middle, because he doesn't have to drive. And then two, he doesn't have to get out and open no gates. That's cowboy life. Every cowboy's got it. It's in the way he lives his life, songs he sings. That's cowboy life. Every cowboy's got it. He's got a simple solution, just about anything. This set is entirely dedicated to cowboy music, music that's very close to my heart. And I know it's close to the heart of many of you out there in the audience. If you've had a chance to live the life, it probably means even more to you. This is a song about living the life, written by one of the greatest cowboy singers living in our time. His name is R.W. Hampton. He's a working cowboy from over in New Mexico, not too far from where I live. He's still out there doing it. Every once in a while, he shows up at the Cowboy Poetry Gathering in Elko
or some of the other cowboy music and poetry events, and he plays his music, and everybody just loves what he does. I really relate to this song because when I was a young cowboy, I worked out on the Paladuro Ranges, which is the second largest canyon in the United States, in the northern part of Texas. Only Grand Canyon is larger. A lot of people don't know about it, but if you're ever in North Texas, around the Amarillo area, where Gary's from here, don't miss a chance to go see the Paladuro Canyon. It's where Charles Goodnight first got the idea to start a ranch and begin to herd longhorns north to beef markets in the east by way of the railroads. And of course, when Charles Goodnight started doing that with his partner Oliver Loving, everybody knows the rest of the results. The real true cowboy, the trail drovers of the 19th century were born. And the soul of those old trail drovers still survives in every man and every woman who gets a chance to be around working cattle and horses. So this is dedicated to the real cowboys out there, the people who are still doing it, people in the cattle business. Because last time I checked, the definition of a cowboy is somebody who takes care of cattle for a living.
The painted walls of Paladuro, how my heart can see them yet. As a boy of 18 summers, long before I knew regret, there I rode, the bold unwilling, and my loop was keen and true. And even in the dead of winter, skies were always blue. In the heat of summer branding, we'd get an early start, jingle in the horses, saddle in the dark. Then we'd ride out in the morning without a spoken word, the ring of spur and the fall of hoof, all that could be heard. It's been saddle horse and catch twine that has been my life. Some say it's been my downfall that the world has passed me by. But the life I've lived I freely chose. I'm at it here tonight. I was born to be a cowboy, and I will be till I die. I first laid eyes on Darcy Taylor at the Cowboys' Christmas ball. She was the daughter of a preacher and the fairest of them all. I knew I could never marry her, but I loved her just the same. I still get that old time feeling when I hear her name. It's been saddle horse and catch twine that has been my life. Some say it's been my downfall that the world has passed me by. But the life I've lived I freely chose. I'm at it here tonight. I was born to be a cowboy, and I will be till I die. Photographs trophy buckle, things you hold with pride. When your eyes grow dim, don't mean as much as what you've got inside. I got lots of memories, to me worth more than gold, and I can say I'm ready, Lord, when it comes my time to go. 'Cause it's been saddle horse and catch twine that has been my life. Some say it's been my downfall that the world has passed me by. But the life I've lived I freely chose. I'm at it here tonight. I was born to be a cowboy, and I will be till I die. I was born to be a cowboy, and I will be till I
die. This next piece I'm going to do is a medley of songs. It was inspired by a conversation that I had with Roy Rogers back in 1988. I knew I was about to make an album of cowboy songs, my first album, which contained only cowboy songs and not country music or pop music. And I wanted to go meet the king of the cowboys. And Roy Rogers gave me two wonderful pieces of advice when I went to meet with him in Victorville, California. It was pretty exciting for me. I saw him up on the screen so many times and on television when I was a boy. And to be sitting across from this king of the cowboys was pretty thrilling. I was speechless. All I could say was, just give me some advice about being a singing cowboy. And the man who sold more theater tickets than Humphrey Bogart or any of the big movie stars of his time, Clark Gable, did not sell as many movie theater tickets as Roy Rogers and Dale Evans sold. Sat across from me eating a tuna fish sandwich, reminiscing about his life. And he said, well, Michael, I'll give you two pieces of advice. If you want to be a singing cowboy, number one, get yourself a really good-looking horse. Because when you get old and ugly, the kids will still like the horse. And then the next thing he told me is something that stuck with me the rest of my life. I'll never forget it. It's so simple, and yet it's such an incredible challenge. He said, if you want to be a singing cowboy and live by the code that I lived by, then do your best to never do anything in public or private that would send a child down the wrong trail in life. Sounded so simple, but when you think about it, have you ever done anything that would send a child down the wrong trail in life? Ever done anything that might influence a kid to go down that trail that he might not be able to come back down from? That little girl might not be able to ever recover from? Think about it. I have. I bet every single one of you have. So Roy Rogers was sitting there telling me, this great entertainer, this great movie star, was telling me that that was his code inside. What if every Hollywood director, what if every Hollywood producer, every single movie company made a pledge right here tonight or tomorrow morning that they would never make a film and no movie star would ever play a role that would send a child down the wrong trail? This would be a different world right now. And about 95% of the films we see coming out today would never have been made. And we'd all be better off for it, too. So this is a medley of songs about trails, all songs about good trails in life that come from the singing cowboy era, when on the silver screen, America was enchanted with the idea of a cowboy who could not only ride and rope and get the girl and vanquish the bad man, but could also sing.
I'm a roving cowboy. I am riding all day long. Tumbleweeds around me sing their lonely song. Nights underneath a prairie moon. I ride alone, but I sing a tune. See them tumbling down, pledging their love to the ground. Lonely but free I'll be found. Tumbleweed. When it's twilight on the trail and I jog along, the world is like a dream and the ripple of the stream is my song. When it's twilight on the trail and I rest once more, please plant this heart of mine underneath the lonesome pine on the hill. Every day along about evening, when the sunlight's beginning to fail, I ride through slumber and shadows along the Navajo Trail. I love to lie and listen to the when the wind is strumming a sagebrush guitar. Over yonder hill the moon is climbing. Hey, it always finds me wishing on a star. And it's night, crickets are calling, coyotes are making a sleep beside a smoldering campfire along the Navajo Trail. Riding down the canyon just to watch the sun go down. That's a picture that no artist ever could paint. White face, cattle lowing on the mountainside. I hear a coyote whining for
find it's heaven to go riding down some old Hoosier trail. Just to watch the evening sun go down. Blue shadows on the trail. Soft wind blowing through the tree. And the lonely way in the distance comes drifting on the east.
Okay, now we're going to get into some really old-time cowboy music, and you cannot play old-time 19th century cowboy music without saluting the music of the Celtic people, the Irish, the Scots, the Welsh, and people who brought their fiddles, their mandolins, and their accordions over to America when they immigrated, had a big influence on our folk music from the Appalachian Mountains all the way out to the West. But you have to say that without a doubt, they influenced cowboy music more than any other form of our American folk music. A lot of cowboys were Irishmen who came right off the boat and took a job as trail drovers. Knew little about American style cowboying, but they made a good hand of themselves. So in order to really give you the true roots and basis of this, I want to invite a man up here who's celebrating his birthday tonight, by the way. He's been to Ireland several times. He's got a number of recordings out of old-time fiddle music, but what he particularly loves, as I do, is Irish music. And in fact, I wear my heart on my sleeve about that, being a Murphy, and I have my Murphy clan crest right here on my sleeve for everybody to see, because I'm proud of being a Murphy and an Irishman. And it fits in really well with my life singing cowboy music. So I'm going to get up here right now, a guy I've worked with for over 20 years. Happy birthday, David. David Coe.
Thank you, Murph. Thank you, everybody. When I first met Michael, one of the things that we immediately started talking about was traditional Irish music and also the old-time fiddle and banjo music of the Appalachian Mountains, which of course is all related. And I realized as I started trying to learn this Irish music that Michael had a real advantage. He was genetically programmed to play and enjoy Irish music, and that I was going to have to go over there and study. And I found a school over there, the Guinness School of Musicology. Have you heard of this place? Yeah, night classes. Lots of night classes.
In fact, they have a branch right here in Evansville. Yes, and we're going to go there later and study, David, for your birthday.
Okay. Oh, wonderful. Okay. But I really do enjoy going over there and renting a car and getting on the wrong side of the road and traveling around and getting to meet musicians over there. It's a fantastic tradition they have over there that they have since spread all over the world. And it is exciting to see that music from the perspective of a cowboy fiddler, and of course they want to hear the tunes that we play, and they're all related, and to find that common ground is really exciting. So these are three tunes that I learned while I was traveling over there. The first is an Irish air, which are slower listening songs, and this one is called
Inishere, and it's named after an island off the west coast of Ireland. The second tune is a jig that I just know as a Kerry jig, so I assume it's from County Kerry. They play a lot of jigs down there. And the type of tune I'm going to play third is a reel, an Irish reel. And you'll hear that tune more than any other when you travel around Ireland. They play lots of reels, and they call them reels because they play them real fast. I figured that one out. And this one has a wonderful title that only the Irish would come up with. It kind of gives you goosebumps when you hear it. It's called The Drunken Landlady. Uh-huh. I put these on my latest CD called The Traveler, and I really hope you enjoy them. Thanks.
All right, now you're prepared to hear the Irishness in a lot of cowboy music, and this next song is a prime example of it. In fact, I'm going to sing it with a little bit, just a tiny bit of a brogue and a jaunt that you would hear when an Irishman sings a ballad instead of singing it the cowboy way. This is about the greatest bucking horse that ever lived, and his fame survives into the present day.
I was hanging around town, spending my time. I was out of a job, not earning a dime. When a fella steps up and he says, I suppose you're a bronc rider by the looks of your clothes. Well, he figures me right, I'm a good one, I claim. Did you happen to have any bad ones to tame? Said, I got one and a mean one to buck. For throwing good riders, he's had lots of luck. Well, he offers me 10 and I says, I'm your man. The bronc, he ain't living, that I cannot fan. The bronc never tried and he never drew breath. I cannot ride till he starves plumb to death. So he says, get your saddle, son, I'll give you a chance. So he hops in the buckboard and we drive to the ranch. The very next morning, right after Chuck steps out to see if this outlaw can buck. Well, down in the horse corral, standing alone, was an old caballo in strawberry roan. He had little pin ears that touched at the tip. He had a big 44 brand on his left hip. He was spavined all round and he had pigeon toes. He had little pig eyes and a big Roman nose. He was eunuch and old with a long lower jaw. You could tell with one eye he was a regular outlaw. While I got the blinds on him, it was a terrible fight. I cinched down the saddle, I girded it tight. Then I stepped on him and I raised the blinds. Look out, boys, he's gonna unwind. Well, he bowed his old neck and I'll say he unwound. He ceased to quit living down here on the ground. Goes up in the east, comes down in the west, and me and my saddle is to doing my best. But he sure was a frog walker. He heaved a big sigh. He only lacked wings for to be on the fly. Turned his old belly right up to the sun. Sure was a sunfishing son of a gun. He's about the worst bronco I've seen on the range. He could land on a nickel and hand you the change. Goes up on all fours, comes down on his side. I don't see how I kept from losing my hide. Well, I lost my saddle, I lost my hat. I was pulling at leather, I was blind as a bat. And with one phenomenal jump, he made a high dive. He left me a winding up there in the sky. And I turned 40 flips, and I come back to earth. I laid there cussing the day of my birth. No, there are ponies that I cannot ride. Some of them are living and they haven't all died. But I bet you $10 there ain't no man alive who can stay on old Strawberry when he makes his high. Well, way up high in the Siree Peaks where the yellow jack pines go tall, old Buster Jiggs and Sandy Bob had a round of camp last fall. They taken their ponies and running irons and maybe a dog or two. They allowed the brand and every long-eared calf that come within their view. Now many a long-eared dogie, the ones that didn't push up by day, had their old hat sizzled and their old ears whittled in the most artistic way. Then Sandy Bob, he said one day as he throwed his old cigar down, I'm tired of this choreography, by gosh, I'm going to town. They saddled him up and they hit him a lope, but it wasn't no sight of a ride. And them was the days that old cowboys could oil up their insides. He started out at the Kentuck Bar at the head of that whiskey road. And he wound up over at Pat Coslett's furniture store 40 drinks below. Well, they set him up and they turned him around and they went the other way.
I swear the God-forsaken truth, them boys is drunk that day. They saddled up and they headed for camp and they's packing a pretty good load. Who should they meet but the devil himself, come prancing down the road. I was the devil himself. Well, the devil said, you cowboy skunks better hunt your hole. I am the devil from Hell's Rim Rock, gonna gather in your soul. Sandy Bob said, devil be danged, we boys is kinda tight. You ain't gonna get no cowboy soul without one hell of a fight. He swung his rope, swung it straight, he also swung it true. He caught the devil with a Houlihan loop, taking his dallies too. Now Buster Jiggs was a re-adam man with his rawhide coiled at knee. He shook it out, made a big old loop, and he latched the devil's hind feet. They stretched him out and they tailed him down and the irons was getting hot. They cropped and swallowed, forked his old ears and branded him up a lot. And they left him there in the CRA Pete's and neck to a blackjack oak. But before they did, they tied a few knots in his tail just for a joke. If you're ever up there in the CRA Pete's and you hear one a hell of a wail, that's just the old devil bellering about them knots tied to his tail.
When I was about 6 years old, my father took me to see the traveling version of the Grand Ole Opry. There was a touring version of that. And we went to a wrestling arena, which at the time was the only performing arts center that we had in Dallas, Texas. It was called the Sportatorium. And it was down there at the Sportatorium, down there by the Trinity River, on a Saturday night that I saw a bunch of Grand Ole Opry performers in person. That the man that impressed me the most who performed that night was a young man who went on to be a big influence on my music forever. I never got to meet him. I got to meet his son, but I never got to meet him in person. I was there when he played at the Grand Ole Opry several times, watching him from backstage. And the thing about it was, when he played at the Grand Ole Opry, he usually came in as a surprise guest. And when he performed, he always completely brought the house down. There was thunderous applause until he decided it was time for him to leave, and then he would go. He was born in Arizona, and when he was a little boy, his grandfather told him wild tales about the Wild West based on his real life. And that little boy went on to write some of the greatest cowboy songs ever, maybe the greatest cowboy song ever. Of course, I'm talking about the greatest composer who ever lived, Wolfgang Amadeus Marty Robbins. And this is his greatest work. I call it classical music, where I come from.
One second. Start that over.
Texas town of El Paso, I fell in love with a Mexican girl. Nighttime would find me in Rose's Cantina, music would play and Felina would whirl. Blacker than night were the eyes of Felina, wicked and evil while casting a spell. My love was strong for this Mexican maiden. I was in love, but in vain I could tell. One night a while Dashing and daring, a drink he was sharing with wicked Felina, the girl that I love. So in anger, I challenged his right for the love of this maiden. Down went his hand for the gun that he wore. But the challenge was answered in less than a heartbeat. The handsome young stranger lay dead on the floor. Out through the back door of roses I ran, out where the horses were tied. I caught a good one, it looked like it could run, up on its back and away I did ride. As fast as I could from the West Texas town of El Paso, out through the badlands of New Mexico. Back in El Paso, my life would be worthless. Everything's gone in life, nothing is left. It's been so long since I've seen the young maiden. My love is stronger than my fear of death. And so I saddled up, riding alone in the dark. Maybe tomorrow a bullet may find me. Tonight nothing's worse than this pain in my heart. And at last, here I am on a hill overlooking El Paso. I can see Rosa's cantina. My love is strong and it pushes me onward. Down off the hill to Felina I go. Off to my right I see five mounted cowboys. Off to my left, right a dozen or more. Shouting and shooting, I can't let them catch me. I have to make it to Rosa's back door. Something is dreadfully wrong, for I feel deep burning pain in my side. Though I am trying to stay in the saddle, I'm getting weary, unable to ride. But my love for Felina is strong. I rise where I've fallen, though I am weary, I can't stop to rest. I see a white puff of smoke from the rifles. I feel a bullet go deep in my chest. From out of nowhere, Felina has found me, kissing my cheek as she kneels by my side. Cradled by two loving arms that I'll die for. One little kiss and in Felina cinched up our saddles, we rode to Sonora last night. Guns hanging proud, daring out loud for anyone looking to fight. Card cheats and rustlers would run for their holes when the boys from the old broken oath rode up and reined on the street that they named Sonora's death row. Whiskey is free in Amanda's saloon for the boys from the old broken home. Saturday night in the town of Sonora. Ah, it's the best in all Mexico. They got guitars and trumpets and sweet senoritas who don't want to let you go. You'd never believe such a gay, happy time on a street called Sonora's Death Row. Now me and the boys, we was a-dancing with some of Amanda's gals. I won some silver at 7-card stud. I was out doing my bell. When the whiskey and the mezcal and the peso cigars drove me outside for some air, somebody whispered, "Your life or your money." I reached, but my gun wasn't there. I woke up face down in Amanda's back alley, aware of the fool that I'd been. I ran to my pony, I grabbed my Winchester, I entered Amanda's again. There I saw my partners twirling my pistols and throwing my money around. So blinded by anger, I jacked the lever and one of them fell to the ground. Amanda's got silent like night in the desert. My friend stared in pure disbelief. Amanda was kneeling beside the dead cowboy, plainly expressing her grief. I bowed my head as a tremble shot through me. My 6-gun was still at my side. I reached in my pockets, there was my money. I fell to my knees and I cried. A nightmare of mezcal was all that it was. Nobody robbed me at all. I wish I was dreaming the sound of the gallows they're testing outside the walls. Whiskey's still free in Amanda's saloon for the boys from the old broken home. I'd give a ransom to drink there today and be free of Sonora's death row. I'd give a ransom to drink there today and be free of Sonora's death row.
I had several requests for this song tonight, and I don't remember the name of the first gentleman who asked me for it, but send it out to him anyway. This is really an old-timer, probably the first cowboy song hit that was really a popular song on a recording. It sold over 1 million copies of the Edison disc that it came out on, which was the first form of recording that you could buy. It was literally a cylinder that fit inside of a thing that looked kind of like a lathe, and a needle would go down on it, and as the cylinder spun around, you would hear the music coming out of a big horn that kind of stuck out. It was called a Victrola. And the Edison disc, invented by Thomas Edison, was a real revolution, sort of like when the Dallas Cowboys won the Super Bowl, you know. Kind of sent everybody back. So this is one of the first songs to ever be recorded. It was a cowboy song, and it was so popular that even though there were only about 100,000 Victrolas in people's homes at that time, it sold 1 million copies. But those cylinders wore out pretty fast. So everybody bought at least 10 copies, and it got up to 1 million. It was written by an Irishman named DJ O'Malley, who came from Montana. And the song dates back to the 1880s. And people ask me all the time, what is my favorite cowboy song? This is my favorite cowboy song. It's so authentic and so true to the kind of people that cowboys were in that time, as I picture them. They were people who at times were rough, but their loyalty to their job was such that they were willing sometimes to die for their job. Till September 11th, it was becoming a rarer and rarer thing to see people who were willing to die just for the job that they have. And then we realized that there are still people around who are willing to do that. In this particular song, DJ O'Malley writes a tribute to a man who dies in a stampede. He's willing to get out in front of the herd and try to turn the herd in the middle of the night in a stampede, and his horse slips down.
A group of jolly cowboys discussing plans at ease. Says one, I'll tell you something, boys, if you will listen, please. I am an old cowpuncher, you see me dressed in rags. I used to be a good one, boys, and I went on great big jags. I've got a home, boys, a good one you all know. Though I haven't seen it since very long ago. Back to Dixie once more to see them all. Going to see my mother when the work's all done this fall. When I left my home, my mother for me cried. She begged me not to go, boys, for me she would have died. Mother's heart is aching, breaking for me, that's all. With God's help I'll see her when the work's all done this fall. Very night, this cowboy went out to stand his guard. Night was dark and cloudy, it was storming very hard. The cattle, they got frightened, and they rushed in wild stampede. The cowboy tried to head them while riding at full speed. Riding in the darkness, so loudly he did shout. Trying hard to head them to turn the herd about. His saddle horse did stumble, and upon it did fall. He won't see his mother when the work's all done this fall. His body was so mangled, the boys all thought him dead. They picked him up so gently, and they laid him on a bed. He opened up his blue eyes, and looking all around, he motioned to his comrades to come near him on the ground. He said, send my mother my wages, boys, the wages I have earned. I'm so afraid, boys, the last year I have turned. I'm headed for a new range, I hear the master's call. I'll not see my mother when the work's all done this fall. Bill, you take my saddle, and George, take my bed. Fred, take my old pistol after I am dead. Please think of me kindly, boys, when you look upon them all. I'll not see my mother when the work's all done this fall. Charlie was buried at sunrise, no tombstone for his head. Nothing but a little board, and this is what it said. Charlie died at daybreak, and he died from a fall. not see his mother when the work's all done this fall.
Thank you. As I walked out on the streets of Laredo, as I walked out in Laredo one day, I spied a young cowboy dressed in white linen, wrapped up in white linen and cold as the clay. I see by your outfit that you are a cowboy. These words he did say as I boldly stepped by. Come sit down beside me and hear my sad story. Shot in the breast and I'm going to die. Oh, beat the drum slowly, play the fife lowly, play the dead march as you carry me along. Take me to the green valley, lay the sod o'er me. I'm a young cowboy, I know I've done wrong. Once in the saddle, I used to go dashing. Once in the saddle, I used to go gay. First to the dram house, and then to the card house. Shot in the breast, and I'm dying today. So go gather around you a group of young cowboys. Tell them the story of this my sad fate. Tell one and the other before they go further. Stop your wild roving before it's too late. Then beat a drum slowly and play the fife lowly. Play the dead march as you carry me along. Take me to the green valley, lay the sod o'er me. I'm a young cowboy and I know I've done wrong. I'm just a young cowboy and I know I've done wrong. Thank you.
You may be surprised to hear that even though death is a theme in a lot of cowboy songs, cowboys actually have a lot of very strong religious beliefs. And this next piece brings out what cowboys believe about the afterlife.
Cowboy asked his friend. His friend replied, "Well, son, it happens when your life has plumb reached its end. You see, they comb your hair and they wash your neck, son, and they clean your fingernails, and then they lay you down in a padded box far away from life's travails. The box in you goes in a hole. Been dug into the ground. And I reckon that reincarnation's a thing that happens when you're planted beneath the mound. You see, the box melts down, son, just like the clods, and you who is inside. That's when you're just beginning on a transformation ride. Because in a while, some rain's gonna fall upon the ground until one day on your lonesome little grave a little flower will be found. Say a horse should wander by and graze upon this flower that once was you, but now you ain't nothing but a vegetative bower. This little flower that the horse done ate up with all of its other feed becomes bone and fat and muscle, essential to the steed. Some is consumed that the horse can't use, so it passes through until at last it lays there on the ground, this thing that once was you. Say one day I should come wandering by and gaze upon the ground and wonder and ponder on this object I have found. Well, darned if it don't make me think of reincarnation, of life and death and such, and I ride away. Where do cowboys go when they die? That's where cowboys go when they die.
Old horse, your days are numbered. Your race is almost run. But I wouldn't sell or trade you, old horse, because of all the things you've done. Just what I'm going to do with you sure has gotten me treed, but I promise you one thing. Nobody will ever come and haul you away to be dog food or chicken feed. You who used to be so toppy, so pretty and so proud and so grand, you're called a public nuisance now by the bureaucrats who run this land. They say away with useless horses. That almost makes me weep. Away with useless horses. Put them all to sleep. And you got yourself a bad ankle, old horse. running the last wolf off this range, and now there's some folks that would like to run you off too. My God, some folks are strange. And I guess you and me are riding for a hard one now, old horse. Could be we're riding for a fall, but you know, I'm going to hold on to you anyway, in spite of all their gall. I'm going to find us a homestead way over yonder on Bitter Creek. And I'm going to plant for us a pasture that'll make us fat and slick. Away with useless horses, some say. Useless old horses, if you please. Hey, they're never going to see that old bad ankle, old horse. Because as long as you're on this ranch, you're going to be in grass that's way up past your knees. She comes down from Yellow Mountain on a dark flat land, and she rides on a pony she named Wildfire. Whirlwind by her side on a cold Nebraska night. They say she died one winter when there came a killing frost, and the pony she named Wildfire busted down his stall. In a blizzard he was lost. So by the dark of the moon, I planted. But there came an early snow. Been a hoot owl howling outside my window now, 6 nights in a row. She's coming for me, I know. And on both gonna go. We'll be riding wildfire, calling wildfire, calling wildfire. On wildfire we're gonna ride, gonna leave. Well, I want to thank everybody that worked on this concert tonight, our director and all the crew, all the cameramen, the sound people, the people who did the lighting. They've spent a long day in here getting this place ready to shoot our video. I also want to thank my family, my stepdaughters in particular, for being patient and staying up late. Some of them are probably already asleep. And that's good, because they have to be on time for school on Monday. And on our ranch, we have to get up early and do chores. But most of all, I want to thank Pat Coslett, because I've never met anybody quite like Pat Coslett. He is definitely one of a kind. He is what American entrepreneurship is all about. He makes no apologies about getting up and selling what he loves to sell with all of his might for the sake of his employees, his friends, and his family and his customers. I don't think you'll ever meet anybody who cares more. He does it all along the way by making us laugh at the whole idea of business, and the whole idea of wanting to spend money, and he makes a party out of it. And that just makes it go better for all of us. I also never met anybody who loves cowboy music more than Pat Coslett. He is the number one fan of cowboy music I guess I've ever met in my life. It's really something. And of course, last and certainly not least, I want to thank my band, who are fantastic musicians. I mean, beyond belief. David Coe on fiddle, Gary Roller on bass, Paul Sadler on guitar, and Hammer Dulcimer. And now we'd like to end our concert by dedicating a song to the man I got to meet just this last Monday in Denver, Colorado, a man who's taking a lot of flack right now, because any time a man stands up and demands justice, that man is going to have some enemies. He's going to take some flack. It was said in my family when I was a young man that a man who has no enemies stands for nothing. It's been a long time since we've had a president who had the guts to say, if we have to go in and get the bad man, we will go in and get the bad man. And he may be the first president that we've ever had who knows how to lead a posse. Well, his dad did pretty good on that, too. Thanks very much for coming, and thanks for allowing us to be here tonight to play American cowboy music for you. I must tell you that when I met the president after our concert and rally in Denver, he came up to me, and he shook my hand, and he looked me in the eye, and he said, Michael, I want to invite you to play music at the White House because I want those foreign dignitaries to hear what real music is supposed to sound like. Now, that wasn't so much a compliment to me as it is a compliment to the greatest music ever, cowboy music.
To the town of Iowa Free, I rode a stranger one fine day. Hardly spoke to folks around him, didn't have too much to say. No one dared to ask his business, no one dared to make a slip. A stranger there among them had a big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip. Was early to the town. He came riding from the south side, looking all around. He's an outlaw loose and running, came the whisper from each lip. He's here to do some business with the big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip. In this town there lived an outlaw by the name of Texas Red. Many men had tried to kill him, that many men were dead. He was vicious and a killer, though a youth at 24. And the notches on his pistol numbered one in 19 more. One in 19 more. Well, the stranger started talking, made it plain to folks around. He was an Arizona Ranger, wouldn't be too long in town. He came here to take an outlaw back alive or maybe dead. Said it didn't matter, he was after Texas Red. After Texas Red. Wasn't long before the story was relayed to Texas Red. But the outlaw didn't worry, men that tried before were dead. 20 men had tried to kill him, 20 men would make a slip. 21 would be the ranger with the big iron. Big iron on his head. Well, the morning passed so quickly, it was time for them to meet. 11:20 when they walked out in the street. Folks were watching from the windows, everybody held their breath. They knew this handsome ranger was about to meet his death. There was 40 feet between them when they stopped to make their play. The swiftness of the ranger is talked about today. Texas Red had not cleared leather when a bullet fairly ripped. And the ranger's aim was deadly with the big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip. And it was over in a minute and the folks just gathered round. There before them lay the body of the outlaw on the ground. Oh, he might have went on living, but he made one fatal slip when he tried to mash the ranger with a big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip. Big iron, big iron. Tried to match the ranger with a big iron on his hip. Big iron on his hip.
Thank you. Good night. Thanks for coming. God bless America.
Hi, welcome to Michael Martin Murphy's Cowboy Cabin Collection.
Murph, How did we come up with this Cowboy Cabin collection? It just seemed to have happened.
Well, it didn't just happen, actually. About 12 years ago, Pat, I decided that as a man, I needed a place to go. I needed a retreat. And even though people made fun of me for it, I built a cabin about 45 minutes away from my house where I could go to be up in the woods, a place where I could go when I'm hunting, fishing, and just in the general outdoors. And I don't know about you, but I spend a lot of time out in the outdoors, and because I do, what I want to do when I come inside is I still want to feel like I'm outdoors. I still want to be inspired about being out in the country. What I realize, I think that a lot of people feel this way, and even in the city, they may want to come home after a job or after work and walk into a place that feels like the great outdoors to remind you what you're going to do on a weekend or to fulfill your fantasy of where you're going to go. What about you? I know you're a hunter, you're a fisherman, you love the outdoors yourself.
The feeling of the outdoors, Murph, and that's what I think, what I know we've created here. You know, I'm trapped in a furniture store every day. I'm trapped in here and
what kind of furniture do you like to come home to?
we're sitting on it, bud. We are sitting on it. You know, men hunt, it's going back a million years, basic instincts. Men hunt, women nest. So we work every day with women coming in, lining the nest with bear furs,
and whatever. That's an important thing for a woman to have that part of her house and for the children to have it, but there is that office. There's that den, there's that basement, there's that cabin in the woods, there's that little hunting place, or that special place that you go, that a man likes to have the stuff around him that makes him feel really at home, makes him feel home on the range, you might say. And that's what the Cowboy Cabin Collection is. I created it for myself. And this is what it looks like in my house at home, 10,400 feet up in my cabin in New Mexico. And I want other people to have this same kind of feeling. Everything feels substantial, it's heavy, it's well built, it can take the knocks. It's I guess what you would say, it's masculine feeling furniture. That doesn't mean it's going to scare women away. My wife, Karen, absolutely loves this stuff, but she's a cowgirl. She loves to ride and she loves to get outside too. And when she walks in, this is the kind of stuff that she wants to have around her. My kitchen and my cabin, it's got it doesn't have fancy tile on the top. It's got galvanized tin on the top, and I cook with Dutch ovens and a lot of cast iron. And it's just a way of making yourself feel a little bit more like you realized your dream. When I was a kid, I wanted to be a singing cowboy, and I know there's a lot of people out there that want the same thing. They love the outdoors, they love the furniture and the feeling, the cabin, the structure, the immediate home environment that makes them feel like they're there. I want to feel like I'm there every minute. But you know, we did have a wonderful benefit here in your store where we set up everything cowboy and everything rustic and western, and I sang cowboy songs, and people were willing to pay a higher ticket and make donations and give to an auction in that environment because all of a sudden they were thinking about what's really important in life. Kids, love, family, hard work. And this furniture collection, I hope, will make people think about that. You don't want to turn on a TV when you walk into a place like this, even if you've got one on right now. Okay, buy this furniture, folks. Turn this commercial off.
We're proud to be a part again of the Michael Martin Murphy Cowboy Cabin Furniture. What I said earlier about men hunt, women nest, I'm going back a million years, basic instinct. Guys, if you want a corner of the house, even the garage, to be your room, come in and get some of this, and suddenly you'll feel like you are living high in the mountains of the Rockies.
And ladies, if you want to give a man back his soul, come and help him out and get some of this kind of stuff. Create an environment that he's happy in too. I can just tell you it's going to make him love you even more.
And if you really love him, you'll even let him put that camouflage recliner right in the middle of the living room. So when the junior league...
Okay, my wife Karen said she's going to stop at the camouflage thing, right? That's going to have to be a line drawing thing.
I'm going to take a... You know what? But we finally have to stand up and be men, Murph.
I'm going to have it in my deer stand. I'm telling you, I'm going to have the cowboy camouflage recliner in my deer stand.
You can put it in... I'm going to take a class on assertiveness because I need a little work, but first I have to check with my wife. So anyway, I'm just... But we're particularly pink. This thing is gonna sell like wildfire, and we're honored that Murph came to see us.
until we meet again. Happy trails.